doing something this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, we welcome you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you, God. We love you, Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. Good morning, Bethesda. How are we doing today? Are we excited to worship? Let's all stand this morning. If you're in this house, I just want to invite you to stand. Hey, buddy. And I just want to invite you to come on up to the front this morning if you want to come and worship. Jesus, Jesus. Yeah, I just would love if any of you want to worship here in this church, you are free to worship and move around as you please. We just want to invite you to the front. Who here is just in love with Jesus? Raise your hand if you're just in love with Jesus. Look, I want to tell you something. You don't have to wait for Warren to play your favorite song for you to get into worship. You don't have to wait for the lights to dim, for the mood to be set, for you to worship the Lord. Do you know that the best worship to the Lord is the worship in any season? Doesn't matter if you're on Sunday, if you're at home, or if you're at a different church or at this church, worship to the Lord in any season is excellent worship. And so we are not here to convince you or here to guide you. We are here to all worship together at the beauty of our King. Amen? So let's just do this. Hold your hands up to heaven with me this morning. It's a special day. It's Family Group Sunday, which means it's a day focused on family and community. But before we even celebrate that, we have to celebrate that we have a God who is the father of the fatherless. That he puts the lonely in families. Hey, buddy. So just pray with me. Holy Spirit, we just welcome you into this place. We just command, God, that you would move in a mighty way this morning over our hearts. God, we pray that there would be just a move of your Spirit this morning that just brings so much freedom and clarity and deliverance in our hearts. God, we thank you and we're excited for what you're going to do. God, we pray through the expectation of hope. I see an infusion of hope this morning over everybody that comes, that there would be a hope that's restored in the Lord. We just release that, God, in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen. All right, let's get ready to worship.
Good morning, Bethesda Church. How beautiful is our King? How beautiful is our Jesus? Actually, here in this moment, why don't we just stand to our feet? And before we receive this morning, can we give an offering to the King? Woo! Yeah! Before we receive anything from heaven this morning, can we search every corner of our hearts? Find every reason that he's worthy. The elders, when I was growing up, used to say, if he doesn't do another thing for me, he's already done enough. I feel the wind of heaven in here, y'all. I want you to lift up your hands. I want you to open your mouth and begin to say sweet things about Jesus. How we adore you, Jesus. We set our affections on you, Jesus. There is no one like you. There is no one like you in all the heavens. There is no one like you in all the earth. There is none beside you. You are Yahweh Yireh. You are the God who sees. You are El Roy. You are the God who has seen our trouble, who has seen our affliction. This poor man cried to the Lord. The psalmist said that he inclined his ear and heard our cry. We thank you, Jesus, for the cross, for the blood, for the resurrection. We thank you for friendship with God. We thank you. You are good in every season. You do all things well. Woo! You do all things well. You do all things well. Yeah. You do all things well. Come on, put it on your lips this morning. You do all things well. Yeah, 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 yeah. You are strong and mighty. You are mighty in battle. You are the God who saves. Your eye is not dim that you don't see our affliction. Your arm is not short that you can't move in power. We lift our voices to bless you, Jesus. Some of you need to speak a little louder. Come on. Boast on your King this morning. Boast on your King this morning. Remind your problems who God is. Remind your enemies who God is. Remind anxiety who God is. Come on, a few more moments. You need to praise in English. You need to pray so you can hear it. If you run out of words, say holy, yeah. Yeah. If you run out of words, say holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy. Holy, holy. Holy, holy. Over every heart and every mind.
Yeah.
Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Yeah.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Sing your name.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every fear and anxiety. To every soul captured by depression, I speak Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets,
yeah.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh. Speak the name of Jesus, yeah. Over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Speak the name this morning. Still confusion, breaking power in your name. Provision and glory, yeah. There's provision and glory in your name. Come on, sing Jesus. Woo! Come on, sing Jesus. Come on, sing Jesus. Yeah. Shout Jesus from the mountain. Jesus in the street. Sing it now. With the authority that it carries. Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountain.
Yeah.
Jesus in the street.
Jesus.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Jesus from my family.
Jesus from my family. I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Come on, shout it out. Shout Jesus. Shut the hell to be bust wide open in your family. Your voice is too quiet for the roar of anxiety in your life. Shout Jesus. Shout Jesus. Shout Jesus till it changes. Shout Jesus till it changes. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Demons still tremble at your name. If I have to park right here for the next 20 minutes, I will park right here for the next 20 minutes. He has not taken your fight. I see a bulldog in the spirit. Hear me by the Holy Ghost. I see a bulldog in the spirit. This is not the season to be timid about your worship. What? This is not the season to be passive about your worship. Your worship is an atomic bomb to the kingdom of darkness. I need every mouth in this building to open and yield praises. Come on. Whoa, Jesus.
So tenderly upon my heart, yeah. I love the way you move, how you just walk into the room. Jesus,
I love the fragrance.
I love the fragrance.
Fragrance of your name.
The fragrance of your name. Poured forth in my heart. Yeah.
See it again. Jesus, I love.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, I love. Fragrance of your name poured forth in my heart.
See, I love the way you move.
And I love the way you move. So tenderly upon my heart. And I just walk into
yeah. Sing, I love.
And I love the way you move so tenderly upon my heart. I love the way you move. You just walk into the room. So tenderly upon my heart.
how you have walked into the room. Oh, one more time, I love. And I love the way you move. So tenderly you pour my heart. I love the way you move. How you have walked into the room. The Lamb of God. Wounded for all sins. Bruised to cleanse the guilt of generations. The Lamb of God. Sing praise, sing praise, you're worthy of it, oh my King, my voice, I'll raise to every kingdom bows its knee, sing. Behold.
Behold the mystery. The high exalted King who hung between these.
Yeah, you did it for me.
The Lamb of God,
wounded,
wounded for all sins, bruised to cleanse the guilt of generations. The Lamb of God.
Offering at his feet this morning.
Sing praise, sing praise. You're worthy of it, oh my King, my voice I'll raise to every kingdom bows its knee. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise.
With the elders and saints in your crowd, with the angels and creatures cry holy, give your life every breath to him now. Give the Lamb the reward of his suffering. Saints, give your crowd, oh, with the angels and creatures cry holy, oh, give your life every breath to him now, give the Lamb, oh, give the Lamb the reward of his suffering, with the elders and saints give your crowns, with the angels and creatures cry holy. Give your life every breath to him now. Give the Lamb the reward of his suffering. With the elders and saints, give your crown. With the angels and creatures, cry holy. Give your life every breath.
Sing praise. Sing praise. You are worthy of it, oh my King. My voice, I'll rest till every kingdom bows its knee. Sing. It doesn't make sense. I'll never cry.
There is but one thing. There is but one thing I cling to. Man crucified long ago. Jesus. The fullness of God in one man. The nature of man in its fullness. I don't think I'll quite understand. Jesus. There is nothing and no one like you. Not a thing in this world could compare. I could search far and wide, I'd be unsatisfied. For there is just nobody there. There is a king on the throne. His voice like the rushing of waters. His eyes melt the heart made of stone.
Yes.
Jesus, there's a king. There is a king on the throne.
His voice
like the rushing of waters. His eyes melt the heart made of stone. Jesus, and Jesus, the hope of the world. Jesus, the way to the Father. Brother.
God's light's far and wide, I'd be unsatisfied, for there is just nobody there. Satisfy me the way that you do. I've sung it before, and I'll sing it once more. Jesus, there's no one like you. Just love you. We lose all love. joy we found just to love you, just to love you. Oh, we cast down our crowns for this joy we found just to love you, just to love you. And we'll cast down our crowns for this joy we found, yeah, just to love you. Oh, to love you. Our hearts yearn and ache. Oh, they burn and break, yeah, just to love you.
Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. What a joy it is just to love you. What a joy it is to give you all that we are, all that we have, every fiber of our being. Place everything into your hands, Jesus, to trust you in every little matter, to rely solely on your grace and your mercy. Jesus, there truly is nothing and no one like you. Jesus. Come on, give him the reward of his suffering. Give him the reward of his suffering. Let go of that anxiety. Let go of that depression. Let go of that fear. Let him be everything.
World to me, I wouldn't trade you
for silver or gold. Yeah. I wouldn't trade you for riches untold. You are, well, you are my everything.
Oh, Jesus. This morning I felt this sweet invitation to truly give him everything, to lay it all down. I feel there's been people in here that you've had this dissatisfaction that you have been seeking. And you profess to, there's some of you that even profess to love God, but you're still like, I'm not satisfied. I'm still dabbling, trying to find whether it's money, trying to find whether it's addictions. There's something that I need to numb this pain that I have. I haven't been satisfied. And I felt as we sang that one line a while back, we sang, give the Lamb the reward of his suffering. That reward is you, right? It was the joy set before him that he endured the cross. It was the joy of seeing you back in union with him, fully living in your destiny, in your true identity. But I had this picture when we were singing of give the Lamb the reward of his suffering, and it was us actually, the reward was us handing over our baggage. The reward was us handing over our depression and our fear and our anxiety. It was handing over our addictions. It was handing over our greed. It was handing over that dissatisfaction, because he truly is the only one who can satisfy. He is the only one who can satisfy. He is the only one that I can be content in. It's us handing over. This morning I woke up and I heard the verse in John 3 where it's, just as Moses raised the serpent, so will the Son of Man be raised up. And I felt this morning, along with handing that baggage, we're also handing over sickness, and we're handing over disease, and we're handing over mental illness. We're handing over everything that we're dealing with, and there is healing this morning for you. There is healing and restoration and redemption for you this morning. And so what we want to do real quick, let's have everybody stand. And if you're in here, if you're hearing my voice, you're in this room. Then you're clearly in this room. Unless you're in like the taken up into the third glory right now, and stay where you're at. If you are dealing, if you have a sickness or a disease, mental health, if you're struggling with an issue, I want you to raise your hand. If you need healing, you need a miracle in your body, raise your hand. Keep your hand up. Because then at the same time, I also, if you're just like, man, Jesus, I have not surrendered all of my life to you. I have not given you all that I have. I have been feeling dissatisfied. I have not been feeling satisfied in you. And I want to know more what that is. I want you to raise your hand. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Can I just get some people? Well, we are the body of Christ, right? We are his hands and his feet. The same Holy Spirit that raised him from the dead lives within you. Find somebody with their hand up. And we're going to pray for them. It doesn't need to be a long prayer. The Lord can do a lot in few words. You can even just speak the name of Jesus over them. Oh, in his name there is healing. In his name, there is grace, there is mercy. Jesus, we thank you, Jesus, for your grace. We thank you, Jesus, for your mercy. We thank you, Jesus, for your freedom. Jesus.
thank you that you are our everything. Thank you that there truly is no one and nothing like you. That no one can satisfy except for you. You said, come, you drink of what I have and you will never thirst again. And so we drink of you this morning, Jesus. We encounter you, we worship you, we give all that we are to you this morning. We'll lay it all down at your feet. Thank you, Jesus. We just declare healing into people's bodies. We command bodies to come into alignment with the kingdom of heaven. We thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, if you needed prayer for healing and it's something you can test it out. Try to do something you couldn't do before. We want to see Jesus get his full reward. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can we just give Jesus one more shout of praise? Can we just give him one more shout of praise? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. That was all y'all got for one more shout of praise? Let's give him one more shout of praise. Come on, let's hear it. Thank you, Jesus. You alone are worthy, God. We thank you, Jesus. We surrender all to you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. Thank you, Jesus. We are going to transition now. Greet your neighbor as you're making your way back to your seat. Stay in this place of just being engaged with Jesus, of surrendering all. Can we thank the worship team? Thank you, guys. Thank you, Jesus. Let's welcome Pastor Tisha as she comes up.
Good job. Oh, what a precious time in the presence of Jesus. I only wear waterproof mascara 2 days of the week. Sundays and Mondays. Sundays for church, Monday nights for prayer. So good. Jesus. So we get to continue our worship through gifts and giving. Isn't it wonderful to be able to tangibly give back to the Lord with our first fruits? Yeah. With our gifts. I wanted to share something a little more personal today with this giving message. It won't be long, I promise. But it's the bravery to let go. And I think a lot about Abraham. I think about Abraham finally holding that promise, his son Isaac in his hands, and then God says, I want you to let it go. And Abraham trusted God so much that he climbed that mountain with his son, ready to sacrifice him. And he believed that even if Isaac died, that God was so good that he would resurrect him. And I don't know about you, but I've fantasized how God's going to provide for me. You know, I imagine it a certain way, and then God does something totally different. It's just the ways of his kingdom. So I want you to hear me. That as Abraham and Isaac climbed the mountain, there was a ram that climbed too. Why did God have Abraham count stars? Because he couldn't count them. Stars represent the magnitude of God. If we can count our stars, God's probably not involved. He wants us to take us from looking at our own limitations, even looking at the promise fulfilled, and lay it in the altar again and look up and try to count what God wants to do through you. Because I've heard it said, I don't know who said this, but God has a dream and he wraps a person around it. And sometimes he'll ask us to give up something, not because he's trying to take something away, but because he wants to fulfill a dream through you. So would you stand with me? We're gonna have a let go offering. If you can't stand, it's okay. God wants to take our focus off of our small limitations. He wants to take our eyes up and try to count the ways he wants to bless us. And so when we give today, let's give with that heart, that trust, that sacrificial, like what Kyle said, give him the reward of his suffering. Let's do a slide. I feel like there's such power in declaring hope over our finances. If we have one ready, if we don't, that's okay. I can just pray. Do we have a declaration? Okay, that's fine. Let's put our hands out. We're going to receive. You see, because giving is not giving first, it's because we've received from him. Yes. Giving is a response. It's an attitude of gratefulness. And so we thank you, Father, for everything you've put in our hands. That little lunch, it may just look like a couple loaves and a little bit of fish. But with you, it can be turned into a multiplied offering. And so, Lord, we give you what we have today out of our love for you, out of our trust for you. We want to count stars with you. We want to dream with you. Remove our focus from what's down here to what's up there. So we look up, and I just pray fresh hope. I want to read this over you. This is a verse in Romans, real quick, and then we'll... Romans 4:18. Against all odds, when it looked hopeless, Abraham believed the promise and expected God to fulfill it. He took God at his word, and as a result, he became the father of many nations. God's declaration over him came to pass. Your descendants will be so many that they will be impossible to count. See, we look at our one thing. Abraham looked at his one son, but God wanted to give him nations. Who? So we're letting go today in Jesus' name. Bless you as you give. Thank you for partnering with Bethesda. We love you so much. And we'll bring up Pastor Anthony for announcements.
Lord Jesus, I'm stuck on that counting stars phrase. Can we put that on a t-shirt? Oh, that was amazing. Just look at your neighbor and say, so good to see you here. Maybe give a hug to someone next to you. Tell them that you love them. Maybe you don't even know them. Just give them a hug anyways. Good introduction. Amen. Are we doing good today, church? All right. Who's excited for the solar eclipse tomorrow? Ooh. All the prophetic people have been going crazy. I'm like, guys, it happens like every 5 years. It's all good. It ain't the end of the world. We don't need to stock on toilet paper again. We're good. Look at your neighbor and say, something good is going to happen to me. Look at your other neighbor and say, something good is going to happen to you. Look at your other neighbor and say, something good better happen to you. Amen. Well, welcome to Bethesda, guys. If it's your first time, we want to welcome our first-time visitors to today's service. If it's your first time, we just wave your hand at me, and we would love to give you a Connect card. Not you. that's my dad over there. But not you either. But our youth are like, it's me. No, we'd love to give you a Connect card. If you fill that Connect card, you can turn it into the coffee cart for a free coffee on us. We would love to bless you that way. Also, who here has a bulletin? Can we just give it up for Liz Lewis for making these bulletins? Absolutely amazing. So Bethesda is a very active church, and every week and every month we have stuff going on at the church. And so if you ever want to wonder, hey, what's happening at Bethesda weekly, what's happening at Bethesda monthly, you can always turn to your bulletin or turn to our website online to be up to date with all of the events that we do. So who here loves pancakes? Anyone here loves pancakes? Well, we did a pancake and prophecy breakfast a couple months ago, and it was amazing. We had so many people. And Donnie's not here. He's not feeling well today. But Donnie Schroed gave like a very special pancake recipe, and it was amazing. It was awesome. Well, we're doing another one of those. We're doing it. Do we have a slide? Yes, the Sunday, April 14th. And so that's actually next Sunday. We're going to meet here at 8 a.m. It'll be going from 8 to 9:30. And it's going to be pancakes and prophetic words. So come get a pancake and a prophetic word. And, you know, it's a great way to get to church early because, one, you don't have to make breakfast. And, two, you can be like, kids, be in your best behavior. We're getting pancakes. And they'll wise up. So, and then you get a prophetic word for, you know, being an amazing parent, for getting them there. So we also have gluten-free options and dairy-free options as well. Who's excited for that? Who's going to go to that? Let's go. All right, we also have Bethesda Prophetic Ministry Training Sunday the 5th. So if you want to grow in the prophetic gifting, we have a special training for you. It'll be after service from 1 to 3. It'll be led by the amazing Andrea Nelson and her team. Come on. I was just thinking yesterday in the shower, where I have all my deep thoughts, that scripture says that earnestly desire spiritual gifts, especially that you can prophesy or shall prophesy. So as a church, we need to, one, desire the spiritual gifts, but also really hunger to grow in the prophetic. Amen? So if you want to grow in that, come the 5th. It'll be awesome. Who's excited for our Northwest Intercessor Conference? Come on. That's coming up very soon. We just found out that Corey Russell and William Hinn are confirmed for the event. It's going to be crazy. I don't even know how we get these people. The Lord just brings them, and it's amazing. I'll bring you up last. Is that okay? Cool. Last but not least is youth camp is coming up in August. Yes! Yes! We are partnering with the Promise Church for Jesus Camp 2024. It'll be August 12th through the 16th, and the cost of per kid to go to camp, it'll be about like 4 days, 4 or 5 days, is $375 per child. And so we are actually starting fundraising really soon, and we're going to fundraise from now all the way into up until camp. So if your kid wants to, help create, earn some money to go to camp, just watch out for the fundraisers that we do. But we also want to invite anyone here that wants to sponsor a child to go to camp. We love so many kids that aren't able to go to camp go every year because of your guys' sponsorships. It's incredible. I mean, we get donations from you guys, not just like $1,000, but one time even like $10,000 or $15,000 just from the church, just to sponsor kids. And it is so amazing to pour into the next generation. Amen? And that just becomes your fruit. When they get encountered by the Lord, you get to reap the benefits of that as well. So that's coming up soon, and we'd love for you guys to partner with us. If you want to register your child, you just scan the QR code, and then you're good to go. So, amen? All right. Can we please welcome back Tisha as she comes back to the stage after offering?
I just wanted to quickly highlight the Shalom Mental Health class. And I wanted to kind of share some backstory about the beginning of the year. I just felt the Lord on doing a specific class for mental health. So I actually asked Andrea and some others to work on that, and she did that. So this is not something she's doing. This is a Bethesda thing, a vision that we feel called to. And I have just seen in this generation such an attack mentally. And so if you're a parent that's struggling with a child that has some mental challenges, if you're in a marriage, if you are in a workplace where you, this is going to be a very rich, rich content where it's not just about mental health, but it's body, soul, and spirit. James said, I pray that you'd prosper as your soul prospers. Amen. Your body would prosper as your soul prospers. So soul prospering is the will of God. God doesn't want anybody to be under a spirit of anxiety, a spirit of fear, a spirit of depression. He gave us a sound mind, right? And so please sign up for that event. We have it starting. This is crazy, but we didn't even realize this, but it's starting on Pentecost Sunday. I felt like that timing was really significant as well. So please sign up for the class. There's a QR code. The fee is simply just to go. She's got doctors coming in. She's got integrated medicine. She's got all sorts of people. This is going to pay for them to come. So it's a very small fee. Today's the last day for this early bird cost of $35. I believe it's 4 Sundays in a row. And I think there's going to be some light snacks and everything. So please come. Please join us for that. Amen.
Come on. Who's going to sign up for that class? Oh, let's go. Y'all better be raising your hands. I'll tell you what. We need a church equipped in this because the current generation right now, can I give a statistic real fast? I'm going to sell you on a little bit more. The current killer of people under the age of 25 from middle school to 25 is suicide. If you take all the disease that are fatal for that age range and you count them all into one thing, suicide is the higher killer of higher than those diseases. So we are in a mental health crisis right now, which the church is supposed to respond to everything that the world is needing. That God's answer to the world is the church. And so we need to get into this to save the lives of those young people, amen? Because those young people are going to turn 27, 28, 29, and they need freedom. They need deliverance, amen? So come on, sign up for this class. It's going to be amazing, and it's going to be awesome. All right, who's excited for the word? We have a very special privilege. It's always special when Ben comes up to speak, but we have the most amazing senior pastor and senior pastors. But it is a blessing to hear from our father of the house, and he is coming, and he is closing our series of together. So would you please stand and give a Bethesda welcome to Pastor Ben as he comes and shares the word. Let's go, Jesus.
Thank you, Anthony. Oh, and thank you. Go ahead. That's my godson. That's my son, Isaiah. I love you, Isaiah. I know. It's hard to be apart. I want to honor someone real quick. How many know we love to honor our volunteers here in this house? And, you know, one thing that I want to continue, and if you're new to this place, what I want to do is to have a culture of celebration. So when we invite someone up that, you know, we would shout them down like we were at a football game or something, and we would see who they are, like, man, that person is serving in this area or that area. And it means a lot. So without further ado, I just want to read this, and then I'll tell you who it is. It says, "This woman of God is a powerhouse in the kingdom. She is not only one of our immersed graduates, but an anointed teacher who creates a bridge of access into heavenly realms to our Bethesda kids. She consistently serves in children's ministry in our dance team. She is a passionate lover of Jesus who burns for worshiping our King. You will find her outside dancing, singing, and being in the sunshine when she can. When God created Jeria, he saw her and said, 'This is good.' We love you, and we are cheering you on in your journey with the Lord. You're a blessed and highly favored woman." By the way, she owns a massage business, and she's no joke. She'll get you good. Book something with her. Let's everyone stand up, culture of celebration, and let's shout Jeria down. Where are you, Jeria? Come on up here, girl. I went to Kenya, Africa with her. She's amazing. She's a huge giver. She's a generous person. And I just want to say I'm so proud of you, honey. I'm so proud of you. I'm so thankful for you. If you don't already have them, if you do, I want to get you something else. But if you don't already have either one of the t-shirts that we have out there, do you have both of those already? The I Am Prayer shirts? Okay. We're going to get you something else, even more special. It's going to be a surprise because you've surprised us in ways. She's actually one of the ones that spearhead Tish and I getting to Africa. If it wasn't for Jaria, she's one of the connections and a big part of it. So anyways, she is a massive blessing. Stretch your hands towards her. We're going to pray for her. Holy Spirit, I pray that Jaria's business would explode, that she would have more work. Maybe you're already full, but I'm just going to say you get more clients that are just so happy and delighted with less effort and less time. So more income, less time. And I thank you that the gift that she is, the servant leader that she is, and the example that she is, extravagantly bless her in these latter days. The latter is always greater than the former. All the time, in a heartbeat. I thank you for my sister. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you, Drea. I can't believe. Bless that girl. Do something for her, and we're going to do something special for her as well. Okay. Can we give our worship team a hand as well? Shout down, Warren. The team. Here's the thing. This is what's happening in this house. One, the Holy Spirit told me years ago that this house would be a house of revelation and understanding. So Ephesians 1, that the spirit, that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened. And that happens. We'll have guest speakers and different people come in, and they'll start sharing. And they're like, I'm sharing things that I've never shared before. And God is actually speaking to me in a way that he's never spoken to me before. So what God does for one, what does he do? He does for another. So it's not just a particular person that we're highlighting to share or speak that is going to be flowing in that revelation. But God wants that revelation, and he has that revelation imparted to you when you go about your business and your sphere of influence. Can I get an amen? The other thing that the Holy Spirit spoke to me first in 2020, or right before the whole COVID thing, was the word, giant all caps letters fell from the sky. I saw this kind of like this vision in my mind. It was the word enough. That word hit the ground, hit the earth. The earth shook. And on the back of that word enough in all caps was written small, the word strategy. Now here's the other thing. God is releasing strategy to the kingdom of God. So when we get in these worship sets and you're thinking, man, this is good, or maybe you're thinking, I can't wait till this is over so we can get to the word, or, you know, whatever, because there's different people that just, but I'm telling you, when you are here in the worship, what's happening, whether you know it or not, is there's an osmosis that's taking place, and strategy is oozing into your being, and you are being transformed, and you're going from glory to glory. You might not know it in the moment, or you might know it in the moment, but believe me, something is happening and taking place. And here's the sign and the wonder. I want to highlight my friend Chris and his son Zachariah this morning over here. You have probably a 5-year-old young man worshiping with the flags, with the little scarves, all of a sudden getting rocked by Jesus. And nobody told him to get down on his knees and on his face and just sit there in the presence for 15 minutes. That was a lingering of, that was the move of God. So you have a multiplied anointing, a generational multiplied anointing happening. It's like Moses and Aaron. When they went into the temple, they're in the Holy of Holies, talking face to face with God, being ministered to. Meeting was over. Moses leaves. Aaron lingers. When you linger and you take the time to bask in his presence, there's things happening inside of you. There's a renewing process that takes place in you. It's like taking fresh oil on a piece of dried leather and pouring it on the leather and slathering it in. And it becomes flexible again. It begins to shine again. It gets those colors again. It gets that smell again. We talked about the fragrance. We sang about the fragrance. And by the way, we have someone who said, hey, Ben, I will take care of those speakers you want to put up around the outside of the building for the homeless situation. And what we're going to do is this, because Christ is a fragrance. He's a sweet-smelling fragrance to some, and the ones that aren't surrendering, he's a stench to. So here's my thought. If, since we're in a zip code that has one of the highest homeless situations, highest drugs, mental illness, and demonized, and they'll camp around here and, you know, we're cleaning up spray paint and needles and human waste and everything else you can imagine. And we have to, you know, make sure we keep this area clean for services and kids, and so it's a safe environment. But at the same time, wouldn't it be cool if those people are like, hey, you got to move on. You can't set up camp here, because what happens is this. From out of the heart flows the issues of life. So if the inside of your heart only knows chaos, destruction, and we let homeless people camp out here, what happens? Chaos and destruction, and it just gets worse and worse. So that doesn't help. So we'll love on them. Sometimes we get cussed out. Sometimes we are allowed to pray for them, a different thing. Sometimes you begin to preach the gospel, and they're like, no, I don't want to hear it, and they go. You know, the demon is chasing them, taking them away. But what if we had worship music playing 24, or, you know, in the evenings here when we get a lot of activity? And then what if we had every once in a while the gospel preached and they knew how much they were loved? What if people got saved, healed, and delivered while they are coming around this place? And the ones that were meant, like the harvest is always now, the ones that were meant to be pulled in now, it would be like a fragrance. They would hear it. It would be like a fragrance. And the ones that were not supposed to be, the ones that aren't going to surrender, it's like a stench, so they just get out of here. I don't know. I just see this whole place transformed. I think we're in a zip code, a place that's known as a desert. God puts us in places. God put you here for a reason, strategy, to be a pool of refreshing. And we can see this whole place transformed. And his burden is easy, and his yoke is light, or vice versa, if I got that twisted around. Is it his yoke is easy and his burden is light? Either way. My point is, I can see it in my mind's eye. I can see this place transformed for Jesus Christ. That what we feel and experience here on the inside and in this room would spill over on the outside and begin to look like heaven on earth. I see that big sign out there Well, there's no sign right now. It's just a big empty sign. But that sign over here that's supposed to turn, I see a digital sign up in there that we can put anything we want in there, but specifically have that say Jesus meetings. I see people from the New Age business community specifically, but I see people in the New Age hearing about a place. I heard about this place that we go to. So they come. And they come, and they have all the success principles. They have all the know-how. They have all the science behind, all the affirmations, all the different things that are, you know, there's a lot of wonderful things, but they're missing the link that holds all things together, Jesus Christ. It's like the missing link. It's like you're trying to do all these things, and there's some soul power in it, but if you don't get the one involved that saves your soul, it's like plugging in. Jesus is like the one that he plugs. It's like getting plugged into the conduit of heaven, and now you're supercharged. And I saw New Age people coming in, surrendering their hearts to Jesus, getting born again, the missing link, trying to do it all on their own strength. Or maybe they're tapping into things they shouldn't tap into. They surrender their hearts to Jesus, and boom. Then the light of the world really starts to shine in their world, and things really change. And if they're influencers, how will that impact the people that they're influencing? All right, I got on a little rabbit trail there. Now it's time for the message. By the way, read Psalms 103, verse 5. It talks about, I heard the word supercharge the other day. I told you I was going to preach, and then I'm going to take you one more place. Psalms 103, the chapter that talks about the full benefit package. The one who heals all diseases, the one who heals all iniquities, the one that saves our life from destruction. Okay, this is your verse. No matter what you're going through, what you're doing, what your current assignment is, God is in it. And he's in the, and this is the business he's in right here. Psalms 103, verse 5. You satisfy my every desire with good things. You've supercharged my life so that I soar again like flying eagles in the sky. If you need to be supercharged, stand up. Just stand up. You tired of going through an existence where you don't feel supercharged? Stand up. We're going to attach our faith to that. I don't know. I think we need some more endless energy and boundless strength in the body of Christ. They shall run and not grow weary. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for supercharging each and every person in this place. That peregrine falcon word, that we would see things from a higher perspective, the Holy Spirit. That we are seated with you, Christ, in heavenly places, far above all principalities, all powers. Thank you, Lord, that you are reminding us. You're reminding us, and we're aligning with your mind, Christ, because we have the mind of Christ, that we are supercharged. And everyone said, all right. Fly back to your little eagle's seat there. And let's go ahead and put up Ephesians chapter 4. And I get to wrap up our series on family. You know, who was it? Anthony. Pastor Anthony just talked about, he said that the answer for like suicide and for the world is the church. And, you know, I would say, and we have many names for the church, right? The church, the family of God, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. And the words that I came up with, that I was thinking of before Anthony even got up here, was the antidote for loneliness, the antidote for people is the family of God. Now think about this. What is the thing that the devil tried to do immediately? If we go all the way back to the law first mentioned, to the tree of knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life, what was the thing that Satan tried to do? One, scarcity. I'm missing out on something. An attack on identity, which led to disconnection from family, the family of God. Scarcity, okay, actually it's rooted in fear. So fear, okay, let's say FOMO, fear of missing out. You guys heard of that statement, FOMO? So fear of missing out, I'm missing out on something. There must be more to who God called me, who I was, created in his image, in his likeness. I'm an image bearer for him. And I've listened to the accuser, the one that tries to separate. By the way, that word accuser, in Revelations, I think it's 12 verse 7, could be wrong on there. But the word accuser, it's actually, I think, where we get the word categorize in the Greek, or to separate. So what the enemy tries to do is he tries to get you to disconnect from your life source, the family of God, and connect to what Proverbs says in Proverbs 4, I think verse 11, it says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end leads to death. So I need to disconnect from my life source, and I need to connect to what seems right, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, but always brings sin. What's sin? Always takes you, sin means missing the mark is one of the Greek words for it. So it always takes you down the wrong path, the wrong way. What did Jesus say? I am the way. It always takes you to something that looks like truth, but it's not. It's a lie. Jesus said, the truth shall set you free. He also mentioned that he is the truth. And it takes you into bondage, which always leads to death. This is why we need to be attached to the vine. John 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you want to bear much fruit, you need to abide and be connected to me. And this is probably a long way of saying we need people to get born again. So when you're born again, it's not just a religious routine or some sort of religious saying, but there's something taking place where all things, 2 Corinthians 5:17, I believe, it says, all things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. I'm a new creation. That's the scripture. So say with me this real quick. And I want you to say it with your mouth. And I want you to mean it in your heart. And if you don't mean it in your heart, because there's some people in here, they need a born-again experience. Okay? I want you just to say this. Actually, say it no matter what with me. Will you entertain me? Can we do what I would call a Holy Spirit experiment? Yeah. Shout me down and say yes if you're in on this. Yes. Okay. All right. Say, Jesus, come live in my heart. Make me into the man, if you're a woman, say woman, that you want me to be. Take away all my sin. Forgive me of all my sin. I surrender my life to you. Holy Spirit, fill me. Okay, now everybody grab the seatbelt, imaginary seatbelt, and buckle up. Because something's going to change in your world. And you guys heard me share that story of my friend who we did that whole thing over the phone. And he was rolling his eyes like, oh, brother Ben. 2 weeks later, he's calling me as we're sitting in a church service. He's texting me, what did you do to me? Shame on you. That's what he said. I'm giving away all my money to people. I'm seeing people on the streets and I'm crying. I don't know what happened. Because he was this tough, gruff guy, you know. And now he's just a lover of Jesus. He still is to this day. So whatever, I say that to say this, whatever you're going through, whatever you're facing, God can begin to shift in a heartbeat. He'll shift it in a heartbeat, then he'll take you on a journey of discovery, okay? All right, Ephesians, here we go, 4, verses 1 through 5. Now we're going to read this real quick, I hope. Oh, okay, can you guys read this with me? I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as we were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of us all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivities captive and gave gifts to men. Now this, he ascended. What does it mean? But that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of the deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part its shares causes grows of the... Okay. All right. Now, I haven't even begun to teach on this, and you're getting excited. You see what the word does when you speak the word out? Now, I want to talk about a couple things, and we're going to get this party started even more in the back. Let me get to Ephesians. Where's it at? Okay. Calling. So Ephesians 4, verse 1, there's this word, calling. You know what that word calling means? To feast. You know what else it means? Invitation, if I can read my own words, invitation to embrace salvation of God. So you have a feast and an invitation to embrace the salvation of God. This is our calling, you guys. Lowliness, by the way, for, you know, the New King James, that just means like humility, you know, moving in humility. So that means to feast, just one Lord, one body. Okay, let me get here. I want to get where I'm going. Verse 12. Okay, so you have these gifts that God has given unto men, correct? And so he's poured that out, and some apostles, prophets, teachers, pastors, you know, it gives you these fivefold ministries, which, by the way, is not limited to just what we would call a church building. I know people that are moving in business that have an apostolic anointing on their life. They have something inside of them, and what they do is they begin to take what's inside of them and they begin to reproduce that all around them. That's apostolic. You know, I see people that use the prophetic. They get encouraging words. They get words from heaven, and they're using that as strategy to get farther in business, and the Lord will partner them up with the right people because they are listening to the Holy Spirit on what they should do. There's teachers that are in the business world that are teaching. You have to teach. There's pastors. You have to pastor and care for people's hearts and souls. You have to administrate. You can't get away from the paperwork and the wineskin. So can we all agree that there's something that goes beyond just a church building? Those gifts are not just for the church. We are the church. Okay, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. Here's the other part. Who are the saints? We are. So it's not just a person with a microphone on a stage on a Sunday in a two-hour service that's supposed to be doing the work of the ministry. You are ministry in action, whatever you're doing, wherever you're going, all the time. Okay, till we come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. This word measure, it's this word metron in the Greek. The word metron is basically your sphere of influence. And how many know God can grow your sphere of influence? And as God grows your sphere of influence, you are only supposed to measure yourself and compare yourself to the fullness of Christ. You're supposed to siphon and tap on his anointing, not on comparing yourself to your brother or sister and becoming envious of them. By the way, the word envy means to see a good in another and make war with it. My father-in-law taught me that one. So we're supposed to siphon and be connected and plugged into our source to be able to pour out our metron on others. Now, what I've seen, and this is the important part of connection and community, is if we stick to ourselves for whatever reason, you know, maybe we were hurt by the church, and so, or maybe hurt, you know, as a kid, you know, there's so many different things that happen, you know, as we go on this journey, and if we do not allow the Holy Spirit to bring that anointing salve oil to heal us, what happens is we either have an open, gaping wound, and how many know that hurt people hurt people, or it scars over, and we've never appropriately, you know, addressed that scarring, and we have, if you have scarring, then what do you get? What is that called where it's just like the scar tissue? It's not flexible like it is. Maybe, and you can become numb, and you can hurt people that way, or you'll have scar glasses on where you think it's someone else's problem, but really it's your own issue and your own problem. And the importance of community is every joint supplies. There's a life flow. What happens when you have a wound, when you have something that happens to you, what needs to happen? You got to have blood flow, right? You got to have blood flow. You have to get healthy nutrients to that area so it can bring a supply, and so you won't have that scarring, you won't have that atrophy, and you won't have that wound anymore. So a lot of times the things that we've been wounded on, how many have ever been wounded by the church? Raise your hand. I'm raising my hand. How many have been wounded by a brother and sister in Christ? Raise your hand. Okay. How many know the same way you got wounded is the same place you're going to find your healing? It's tough, but it's needed. So what happens is this. If we decide to isolate, maybe we are on fire, maybe we were just going for it, but you know what? We begin to isolate, we pull back, kind of like Elijah in the cave after he had this beautiful victory against Jezebel, killed all these demonic people. Jezebel threatens him, and he's just like, God, I'm the only one left. And I run, he hides in the cave, and he's listening. But how many know isolation, if you stay in isolation too long, I'm not talking about pulling away to get in your prayer closet. Some people have pulled away for years, and they're still not healed, and they're still not better. One, you can hear from the Lord, but if you don't have a wisdom of a multitude of counselors and you can't hear from his body, your perspective can get way off. It's true, because I'll have people tell me, I heard from the Lord. I'm supposed to go do this. I'm supposed to go do this. I'm supposed to go fast, and I'm supposed to pull away from the body and be alone. And the last person that told me that, he ended up taking his own life, unfortunately. But I felt like there was a roadblock there because he told me the Lord told me to. Oh, if God told you to, hands off. You're basically saying you don't want my input, or you don't want my feedback, or you don't want my counsel, which I'm not saying you have to, but I'm just saying there's sometimes... You know, Jesus left the 99 to go after the one. Throw up that picture of that sheep for me. Have you guys ever heard of Shrek the sheep? Let me tell you about him. Shrek the sheep got away from the 99. He was the one that Jesus was talking about. And they thought Shrek just died. They're like, he's gone. He's dead. They find him wandering in caves and around the cliffs 6 years later. Now, 6 years later, he's got this huge coat of wool that he's carrying around. He can barely see. He can't see straight. He probably stinks. He's hanging out in caves by himself. And when they finally sheared him of that burden, by the way, if you're the one by yourself, and you, if anyone in here, you know the one that's out by themselves, bring him into this community. There is a bunch of amazing people in this community. So this is what can happen. We can get so hurt or... you know, whatever goes on in our life, and basically everything that we face on the negative side is a result of fear. So we can, out of fear, and this is a good exercise to do, you'd be like, God, you're coming up some sort of trigger inside or whatever the case is, you'd be like, God, what am I afraid of right now? And maybe even just confess that I'm afraid of, if I reach out to that person about this, that I'm going to get rejected. And then maybe we'd lose our friendship. Or whatever the case. Sometimes just confessing it out, you realize, especially with a multitude of other believers, you'll realize, oh, wow, in a safe place, okay, I was believing a lie. So what happens? The wool is like self-protection. I'm in fear. so I have to self-protect. But what happens is when you self-protect like that, you become burdened down. And you carry, when they sheared him, it was 60 pounds. You're carrying around of an extra 60-pound load that you were never meant to carry. Wow. Jesus was like, I want to shear that off of you. And you are my gift to the world. But how that gift gets out to other people is through the power of community and being around others. Now, again, you can be around other sheep. What happens? Sometimes your old Ben, people rub me the wrong way. How many got rubbed the wrong way by someone? Maybe you're getting rubbed the wrong way by my message. I don't know. But my point is this. For every rub, there's a revelation. And when you go through hard things that hurt, God is in that hurt. He's bringing the healing not only for you, but to actually bring freedom to others as well. So there's revelation in the rub. So this is what happens when we isolate. But when they sheared that wool off, 60 pounds of wool, that was enough to make 20 men's suits. So you see how the enemy wants to distort your gifts that God has distributed to each and every person. And he wants you to keep it all to yourself and just get this whole burden thing. But God wants to shear you, help you to create beautiful suits, beautiful scarves, beautiful mittens, beautiful things for others to wear and distribute those gifts that are inside of you to the world. This is the importance of family. Family is God's secret weapon. Why do you think we are where we are right now? And the distortion of identity, the breakup and the destruction of family is so in your face right now. I'll tell you what's happening. Because the devil always overplays his hand. There's a bunch of people looking for love in all the wrong places. And they're about to run into the King of Glory. And the King of Glory is going to flow through its body. Ahead, Jesus doesn't run around by itself. It has a neck. It has shoulders. It has a chest. It has legs to move around. And the terrain of his robe definitely fills my temple. It fills your temple. See, the terrain of his robe fills my temple. Now, here's the thing. In that time, any king that would conquer another nation, they would take the train, they would take something from that other king or queen, and they would attach it to the train of his robe as victory. Like, this is who I conquered. Think about the woman with the issue of blood when she touched the hem of his garment, the train of his robe, and the blood stopped immediately. May I suggest that the body of Christ is wearing the righteous robes of our Savior, and without you being you in a place of community, others cannot come and touch the train of the robe of Jesus and have the issue that the wound that's gushing blood get healed up apart from you in community. We need each other. So I want to end the service, but we're not going to quite end. And I have so much more on this subject of community, the power of community, the power of sharing a meal together. You know, the women just got together, ladies' night. It was funny, only 6 people registered for the ladies' night, but there was like, what, 40 women in there? And I'll tell you find things out about, there's only so much we can find out about each other here. By the way, if you let's all stand up. We're going to take a minute. If you're part of a family group and we're highlighting a family group or ministry, I want you to go back, leaders, to your tables right now. But we want to take a little bit of time this afternoon, and I think because of the lack of people that are in the room, we'll probably do this for a few Sundays, just because, sometimes there's people that are out of town, or they just don't make it to church. But I want to take a time. One, I saw a vision years ago before Tish and I started Bethesda, and it was a bunch of wells that were, there was three types of wells. One, there was brand new wells that were dug. And wells represent water. I thought about Jesus in John 4, the conversation, by the way, that he had with the woman at the well. There was those wells, brand new wells. There was wells that were full of rocks that were pulled out and redug. And then there was other wells that were tweaked for a better flow. And they were to the point where they were overlapping. And I look at wells as people that are flowing in this Holy Spirit. And there's other people that need a drink, and they need to have a conversation with you. So I want to just end the service in two ways. One, I'm going to bring Ken and Lori up here. Ken and Lori are going to come up. They help lead our miracle team. And two, so by the way, if you need a miracle in your life and you need prayer for anything, we're going to have a few people up here to do that for you. But at the same time, please don't just exit and leave. Will you guys go back there and check out the wonderful family groups that we already have going? Get to know who they are. Maybe there will be a lifelong divine connection for you, or ministry back here. There's ministries as well. And go ahead. You guys can start moving right now. We're just going to end the service. But I'm going to have Ken pray us out over the word, and then also anything else you want to do, Ken.
Let's give it up for Ben. Thank you, Ben, so much. It's a great word. Thank you all for being a part of our family, and I would second what Ben said. If you feel like you want more of a connection, we ask that you go back and look at the booths and the different groups that we have going on and get plugged in. There's something that happens when you plug in to a group within the church and just stay hungry for the Lord, stay hungry for growth, stay hungry for connection. We're here for one another. We love you. I just want to release, the Lord's been highlighting the book of Isaiah, and real quick, specifically Isaiah 53, 4 through 5 this morning again, it said, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." So the word for griefs in the Hebrew word is kolai, which means sickness. And the word for sorrows is the Hebrew word makab, which means pain. And this certainly applies to both physical and emotional pain. So I would just ask that you make it your own. And Father, I just thank you right now for this body. I thank you for your children, Father. I just